Well, welcome everyone. Very nice to see you all. Thanks so much for joining us for this book launch event for Tobias Cremer's new book, The Godless Crusade, Religion, Populism, and Right-Wing Identity Politics in the West. My name is Judd Bertzall. I serve as a senior research fellow here at the Berkley Center. I direct our project of the Transatlantic Policy Network on Religion and Policy. I first met our speaker, Tobias Cremer, back in 2017. He was just starting his PhD at Cambridge at the time. I had recently, at that point, finished mine and was doing a bit of teaching and setting up a research center there. And he presented me with two research proposals for what he might do during his PhD years. One was a study of late 19th century Victorian geopolitics with a particular focus on the British Empire and its contestation with Germany. The other was a much more contemporary study of the role of religion in right-wing nationalism in transatlantic perspective. I had just written my dissertation on Obama, so I was very focused on sort of contemporary politics. I encouraged him to go in that contemporary direction. I'm glad he made a very wise choice, and so I take full credit for the book and for all the professional success that Dr. Cremer has had since then. Of course, I jest, but he was a wonderful colleague at Cambridge. We worked together in a center there, and he's also been connected here to the Berkley Center and to Georgetown. Just briefly in terms of his bio, Dr. Cremer studied politics, philosophy, and economics at Sciences Po in Paris. Did an MPP at Harvard Kennedy School, an MPhil at Cambridge, and a PhD at Cambridge, and now is a postdoc at Pembroke College, Oxford. Well, Tobias, thank you so much for joining us today at Georgetown. He's no stranger to Georgetown, having been a visiting fellow here at the Berkley Center during his PhD years. He's given several talks in person and virtual here at Georgetown. So. Please join me in welcoming back to Georgetown Dr. Tobias Cremer.
Yeah, thank you very much, Judd, not only for the kind invitation and introduction, but also for your involvement in the genesis of the book. As you said, this is very much due to you, so also if you find any mistakes in the book, this is also entirely due to Judd. But it's really fantastic to be here to be here again after a couple of years, because I was just thinking about it. Last time I was here was pretty exactly 3.5 years ago. I think it was in the end of February 2020, because I was here in 2019, 2020 for the field work for this book. I was interviewing populist leaders, politicians, and faith leaders, and it's a special occasion to come back here and now, having had the support of the Berkley Center, be able to present the fruits of their labors to some extent, and I hope that they won't then draw the conclusion this was a terrible mistake to bring me here in the first place. I'm going to pretty much jump straight into it, talk maybe for like half an hour, and then hopefully have a couple of discussion, because for me it's also, this is a great opportunity to get some of the feedback. And as Judd already said, the title says it all. The book is about religion, populism, and the rise of right-wing identity politics. But before really going into the nitty-gritty of this problemat of this issue, I thought I'd start out by taking you onto a little imaginary journey through a couple of cities in Europe and the US over the last few years, and begin this journey in my own home country of Germany, and more particularly in Dresden, in Germany's beautiful capital of Baroque that might be familiar to some of you. And I want you to just imagine yourself walking through these beautiful Baroque streets. And then you suddenly, as you enter the main market square, you come across this huge crowd of people, several thousand of them, and they are carrying oversized crosses, they are singing church hymns, and they are carrying candles as they gather in front of the Dresdner Frauenkirche, the main Protestant church in Dresden. And then imagine that the second stop of our journey takes us to France, a few hundred kilometers to the west, and particularly to Paris, where we come across another crowd of people. again several thousand. This time they're gathering around the statue of a Catholic saint and preparing to march through the streets of Paris in that saint's veneration. And then finally, let us imagine that our journey takes us back here, specifically just, I think, 3 miles west from here to the National Mall, where we find a third crowd of people, again, several thousand of them. And they, too, are carrying crosses. They are waving Jesus Saves flags, and they are blaring Christian music from their speakers. Now, what is interesting about these three events is that none of them took place in the context of a religious service, procession, or any other form of religiously organized gathering, but that all three were instigated by right-wing populist movements, the first by the patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of the Occident, Germans like short and memorable names, also known as Pegida, it's the anti-immigrant movement in Germany. The second were images from the Front National, which is now the Rassemblement National's annual gathering in the honor of Joan of Arc on the 1st of May. And the third were, of course, scenes all too familiar to most of you from the pro-Trump protests that ended up in the deathly riots around the US Capitol in January 2021. And these events are actually representative of two broader developments in Western societies, with on the one hand the rise of right-wing populism that in many countries is in fact no longer a fringe movement, but that can form governments and even win majorities. And then on the other hand, the resurgence of references to religion, and in particular to Christianity in the political debate of many Western countries that most academics had perceived only a few years ago as secularized, or at least on the path towards further secularization. And given the nature of the three events that I just described to you, one may now, of course, be tempted to think that both of these developments, the rise of the populist right and the return of references to religion, are part of one and the same cultural reactionary backlash, as Pippa Norris put it, or that really the populist right is just one of the latest manifestations of white Christian nationalism that has played a role in American society for many decades. However, while there is certainly a lot of important truths to that, my scholarship is trying to complicate the picture a bit, because I think if we look at it a bit more closely, and if we maybe move specifically beyond the US in our analysis, we can see some factors that make things a little bit less straightforward. So if we look at the numbers, we see that yes, in the United States, Trump is and remains incredibly popular with white evangelicals, not just white evangelicals, also white Catholics and mainline Protestants, receiving, I think, 81% in 2016 of white evangelicals, 83% in 2020, so even increased his votes. But what is interesting is if you then look at some of the data that during the primaries, in the very beginning, he actually did best among those Republicans who never attend church, whereas he significantly underperformed in comparison with those that go to church very regularly. And if we try to remember, it's hard to remember now because things have changed a lot, but if we think about 2015-16 and even 2019-2020, a lot of the what we might have thought of as evangelical establishment, people like Russell Moore, magazines like Christianity Today, have actually been quite outspoken against Trump. And if we look to Europe, the situation is even more complicated, because here we actually have an empirical finding that suggests that supporters of right-wing populists in populism in Europe tend to be disproportionately irreligious. We saw that as the very example that I just showed you of Dresden, there was actually a survey taken at the very demonstration where people running around with these oversized crosses in Germany's national colors, and it turned out that of these people running around with these crosses and singing church hymns, over 80% self-identified as irreligious or atheist in a country that at that point was still 65% self-identified Christian. And that is something that we can see throughout Western Europe in many ways, where we see that things like church attendance and religious practice, in fact, often turn out to be one of the strongest empirical predictors against voting for the populist right. Some scholars even speaking of a religious immunity or a religious vaccination effect against right-wing populism. So how can we make sense of this development? And this is what I try to do in my research and what I try to replicate in my book, and is basically approach this question or this conundrum in four steps. First, by looking at the social origins of right-wing populism. Why is this happening right now? Why is this happening across so many countries? What is, and are these movements actually comparable? What makes them different? What makes them similar? What drives them? And then the second question is, how does religion fit into this? What do right-wing populists actually mean when they talk about Christian identity? And how might that be comparable, different, or similar to, say, a Christian democratic party talking about Christian values, or a conservative, a compassionate conservatism, a conservatism of a George W. Bush. The third question is then how the strategy works out in practice. How do Christian voters in different countries actually react to that? What are some of the variations? And then the fourth question is, what are the factors determining this variation that we can see on both sides of the Atlantic? But first thing first, what are the social origins of right-wing populism? And here, the key finding of my book and my research is very much that the search of right-wing populism is to a large extent less related to traditional economic or moral issues, but much rather the consequence of the emergence of a new social cleavage centered around the question of identity, the question of how to define identity in a time of secularization, individualization, globalization, of how to then define national identity, how to answer the question of who are we and who are the others, who may belong and who may not. And for all those of you who had better things to do in their 20s and over COVID than doing a social science PhD, very briefly, social cleavages basically refer to the main divides within a society that shape and define the political system of that society and the parties that populate it. And historically, in Western societies, we had two main defining cleavages. On the one hand, we had the economic cleavage between state interventionism and the free market, between workers and capitalists. If you want to call it, this is the class struggle. And then we had a second main cleavage, which is the religious or moral cleavage between religious conservatism and social liberalism. That's, so to speak, the culture wars. And historically, you could place most political parties pretty straightforwardly in this 2x2 matrix. So if you, this is like a bit of a European, but like, yes, if you can keep that, is a bit of a European bit, but you can see that, for instance, conservative parties, Christian democratic parties, broadly right-wing parties would be more on the social conservative end of the moral cleavage and more on the free market end of the economic cleavage, whereas social democratic parties, socialist parties, or center-left parties more broadly, also the Democratic Party in the US, would be more on the end of the secular end of the social liberal, of the religious and moral cleavage, and on more on the side, relatively, of state interventionism on the economic cleavage. And then you have classical liberal or libertarian parties being more socially liberal, but also economically liberal. And as a result, for most of the 20th century, our Western politics have been very much dominated, on the one hand, by struggles between these parties about, on the one hand, economic redistribution, taxation, and class relations, and then on the other hand, by social issues such as abortion, state-church relations, and sexual freedom. But what is interesting is that if we look at right-wing populist parties, it's a little bit harder to place them as straightforwardly on this 2x2 matrix if we take them as a party family across different countries, because in many ways we see them on both ends of the economic cleavage. If you think, for instance, about the Tea Party movement, but also the early AfD movement, the early far-right movement in Germany, or many right-wing populist movements in Scandinavia, they initially were very much a free market party, a no-tax or low-tax party, and very much on the free market end of the economic cleavage. But if you look a bit closer, more recently, many of these parties will actually end up on the more state interventionist side of the divide. Just thinking about the protectionism of Donald Trump, that is perhaps less free trade oriented than some of his Republican predecessors. Also the Rassemblement National, if you just look at the economic policies, they probably are closer to the Socialist Party of France than to the party of Macron. And you could actually see that very recently in the around the demonstrations against the introduction in the putting the retirement age up, where the Rassemblement National really said, like, we are the defenders of the French welfare state against the liberal Macron party. So we can really see that they are like on both ends of this divide. And especially to an American audience, perhaps even more surprisingly, is that it's also hard to place these parties as a party family that straightforwardly on the religious and moral divide or the culture war divide. Because on the one hand, of course, we have in the United States the Republican Party being traditionally much more socially conservative, and you have this association between Trumpism and many socially conservative views. But if you look a bit more to Europe, you actually see that parties there are also on both ends of the divide. You see in the Netherlands, people like Geert Wilders saying, we are the real defenders, the populist right is the real defenders of gay rights against conservative Islam. The French Rassemblement National will say, we are the real defenders of secularism, of a strict separation of state and church. And you will have, for instance, the AfD in Germany saying, we are the real defenders of feminism and women rights against socially conservative religious people, which sometimes makes for very interesting bedfellows. I don't know how many of you have watched the National Conservatism conferences. That sometimes then gets a little bit funny if you have people from the Christian right in the US sitting on the same podium as somebody like Geert Wilders, and Geert Wilders saying, like, yeah, gay rights, like, we have to defend gay rights, we are the real defenders of gay rights. Doesn't always go down that well, doesn't always get him all the applause he might have hoped for in an American audience. And whether or not you buy all of these policies, whether or not you think, okay, they actually are defenders of state-church separation, et cetera, whether you think that's authentic or not, I leave this entirely up to you. There are certainly question marks. But my point is to an extent that the very flexibility of this party family on these issues suggests that their core policy, their core issue is neither the class struggle nor the culture wars, but it lies elsewhere, and specifically in the question of identity politics. And indeed, if we look at the polling data over the last few years, we see that it's really concerns about issues like immigration, national culture, and national identity that increasingly trump economic, social, and moral issues, in particular with right-wing populist voters. And this indeed suggests that the erosion of traditional sources of group identity through processes like secularization, individualization, and globalization might have led to some extent to a crisis of identity, also in parts of the majority population, and a consequent new cleavage, if we could get the next slide, exactly, about the question of how to respond to this identity crisis, how to redefine identity in this context. And this is a divide between, on the one hand, a globalist approach focused much more on universalism, multiculturalism, and diversity that embraces group identities really primarily for minorities and favors much more individualist forms of identity for the ethnic majority. And then opposed to that, on the other end, a much more communitarian approach that uses clearly defined sources of national identity based on inherited group identity markers, such as ethnicity, culture, history, institutions, and language, as an alternative to define who we are and how to define identity in this context. And there's, of course, increasing scholarship on that. I'm not the only one talking about that. Some of you might be familiar with the term, which I think was initially coined by the British commentator David Guttard, who called it the divide between somewheres and anywheres. Others refer to it as the divide between open society and closed society, nationalists, globalists. I called it the communitarian globalist divide or communitarian cosmopolitan divide. But whatever you might want to call it, one common feature is that traditional parties have often been perceived as not fully representing and responding to this new divide, and that it is now by making national identity and immigration the centerpiece of their agenda that right-wing populists seek to politicize this new social divide and tap into the new market niche with their own form of right-wing or white identity politics that in a way mirrors but reverses the identity politics of the left, in that the right will use some of the same language and claim to, for instance, they will claim to defend the group rights, the cultural group rights of the ethnic majority rather than that of minorities, with of course the difference that one of these group rights implied is that of cultural hegemony. But like, it's quite interesting that they're using a very similar language and try to mirror this language of the left. The question is now, of course, how religion fits into all of that. And that is, oh yeah, this is just like a bit more, exactly. And the second question is how religion fits into this. And one of the key findings of my research here has been very interesting, in that right-wing populists, and even in the interviews they were giving me, were very open about that, that right-wing populists are using Christian symbols, they are using Christian language in the context of this identity politics, primarily as insignia of a culturalized Christianism, in many ways as a symbol of whiteness and Western civilization that to some extent is interchangeable with things like Viking veneer, neo-pagan references, or the Confederate flag. But at the same time, they often remain distanced from religious values, beliefs, and institutions. And it often helps, if you can have the next slide, to better understand that, to think of the right-wing populist worldview basically as a triangular relationship. Between, on the one hand, the pure, the good, the homogeneous people. These are the good guys. This is the us. And this us is threatened in its identity by a set of two others. On the one hand, you have the internal other. Exactly, that's the corrupted liberal elites, that's Judd and me, who threaten the identity of the pure homogeneous people through their cosmopolitanism, their liberal values that put this identity into question. And then on the other hand, you have the external other. And one interesting development that has actually been pointed out by Jose Cosanova of the Center is that over the last 20 or 30 years, this external other is increasingly defined in cultural, civilizational, and specifically religious terms, and very often specifically as the Islamic other. If you could have the next slide. And it is often only this religious definition of the other, given this religious definition of the other, that then Christianity comes in right-wing populist rhetoric as an analogous cultural identifier of the us. But what this means in many ways is not necessarily a return of conservative religiosity to or religious fervor to the political debate, but in many ways this is much more a culturalization, perhaps even a secularization of the concept of religion itself. Religion here really primarily as a way of identifying the national community It's in a way a dissociation of belief and belonging, of religion as a faith, from religion as a cultural identifier. And what was striking to me was that right-wing populist leaders were themselves quite open about that. So I've overall interviewed, I think, 116 people, right-wing populist leaders, mainstream party politicians, and faith leaders. And one of the questions that I asked all of them is, you talk about Christian identity, but how do you actually define that? What does it actually mean to you? And it was quite striking that when I asked that question to faith leaders, but also to traditional Christian democratic, conservative, mainstream party politicians, so to speak, almost all of them would start talking about theology. They would start talking about the sinfulness, the Trinity, the resurrection, the second coming of Christ. By contrast, when I asked the same question to right-wing populist leaders, they mainly started talking about cultural aspects. They would start talking about architecture, music, traditions, and sometimes even history and geography. And crucially, almost all far-right leaders, right-wing populist leaders I talked to, and that even in the US, which is interesting, would, in their definition of Christian identity, talk about Islam. So they would be saying, like, we are Christian because we have a church in the village. We might not go to that church, but we have a church in the village and not a mosque, and that matters. We are Christian because we have Easter and Christmas off. We might not go to church on these days, but it still matters that we have these days off and not Ramadan. In a way, we are Christian because this is part of our civilization. It's just a question of belief. And just to give you a couple of examples, if you could have the next slide. And again, there we go. Just a couple, so you can see these are like original quotes from some of the right-wing politicians, because they really made that quite clear to me. You have one very high-level AfD politician who put it quite bluntly that in the AfD, the far-right party in Germany, the consensus is that when we say Christian or Occident, we mean it in historical and cultural terms rather than theological terms. It's about defending our culture against other civilizations and the threat of Islam. Another high-level politician of the Rassemblement National said similarly that the religious question will necessarily be central, but it will be in relation to the question of Islam. And perhaps in relation to political Islam, there will be a will to defend what defines us, and, well, then Christian identity is somewhat hard to avoid. But that person also, she also told me that it's very clear this is something cultural. This is not something about religious faith. And interestingly, even in the United States, a senior member of the Trump campaign told me that they're, in fact, that taking back our country now, in fact, doesn't mean Christianity in the way that it did in the 80s. Now it means nationalism. It's less religious, more political. There's no doubt about that. And that is quite representative of the conversations I've had. And what is perhaps even more interesting is that under the surface of these identitarian references to Christianity, really in civilizational terms, at times I even found quite explicitly anti-Christian currents in some of these parties. So if you can have the next slide. Former AfD politician told me that there are many people in the AfD who outwardly say that Christianity is extremely important to them, that they are Christians themselves, but who internally always fought the Christians in the party. They really wanted to destroy us. For these people, Christianity is really a religion from the Near East, which does not fit into Germany. And this, I can now say, because he's released that, this is Jean-Marie Le Pen himself, who said that in France, it's quite clear that the strongest current in the Rassemblement National is now a secularist current. Now, the situation in the US is, of course, different, because the Republican Party is still clearly, or positions themselves clearly as by far the more religious party in public discourse. And you would not necessarily expect anti-Christian references, even from the most populist parts of that party. However, even in the US, I found that a lot of people would tell me that there was a bit of a shift in the Republican Party taking place, and that was not just about Donald Trump's personal demeanor, that didn't necessarily fit with all the family values that earlier Republican officials had talked about, but that also, unlike earlier Republican candidates and unlike many of his competitors during the primaries, Trump barely referenced Christian values or belief in his speeches and really focused on cultural identity issues like the war on Christmas and really these identitarian questions rather than issues of personal faith. And if we can take the next slide, you could actually see that as well, what I mentioned earlier, that in many ways, yes, you see the references to Christianity in much of this movement, but you also see references to other white European civilizational indicators such as, can we go back? I think that jumped. Such as Viking veneer, neo-paganism, the Confederate flag. So in some ways, Christianity or references to Christianity have become interchangeable in that because the purpose that it fulfills is that it's an identifier of whiteness or of the ethnic majority. And if you actually talk to some of the people in the populist right, it's also interesting that intellectually they will tell you, if you ask them, like, what are the intellectual influences, and they will not talk to you about, I don't know, Billy Graham or authors like that, but they will start talking to you about this gentleman, Charles Maurras, who in France was one of the pioneers of the identitarian movement. And wanted to do the same thing, like an identitarian idea of Catholicism, got excommunicated by the Catholic Church because he tried to do exactly that, a dissociation of Catholicism as a cultural identity while openly being atheist about that. And these are now influences that we can see within the national populist movement also in the United States. And maybe just one last note on that, it was also interesting to me. I talked to a lot of people in Donald Trump's faith advisory board, and then to some people on the more populist end of the divide. And they would also tell me that actually within the White House, there was quite a lot of competition between, on the one hand, the evangelicals in the White House, and on the other hand, people like Steve Bannon, Steve Miller, who more epitomized this populist, secular populist movement. And one member of the faith advisory board told me that Steve Bannon was in fact trying to get rid of the evangelicals in the White House, but that evangelicals also played a role in getting rid of him in the White House. So there is some, there is really some tension between these two movements. Now the question is, of course, and this is the third point, how does this strategy work out in practice? How do Christian communities, Christian voters actually react to that? And you see there's actually a lot of variation. In the United States, this is what is most covered in the media. You see, of course, overwhelming support of white Christians for Donald Trump in the US, which you see here, and I think that was prior to the election, this is still 78%. I think in the end it was 83% of white evangelicals and also majorities of white Catholics and mainline Protestants. But in Europe, you see a contrary trend. In Europe, I just gave you the data here of the AfD in Germany, where the AfD on average does about double as well among irreligious voters than they do among Protestants and Catholics. And that is quite consistent. That is also consistent not just within Germany. You can also see that in other countries. You can see in France that the Rassemblement National consistently underperforms among practicing Catholics. We see similar developments in most other European countries, the Netherlands, Scandinavian countries, Italy, etc. And maybe one interesting point that I already mentioned was that even in the US, in the primaries, Trump too initially performed best among those Republican primary voters who never attend church. He did about double as well among those Republicans who never attend church than he did among frequent churchgoers. So that, of course, raises the question, first of all, why has this changed? Why do we still see this vaccination effect in Europe but not in the US? And what are the factors determining that? Which leads us to the fourth point. And there, in particular, I think I've identified two key factors that play an important role here. On the one hand, we have a political factor, and that is specifically the political system in which these parties operate, and specifically the availability of a Christian alternative in the party system. And here the logic is in many ways that Christian voters, it's not a matter of Christian voters being more or less pro right-wing populist or like holding specific attitudes, but they're usually in European systems simply already bound to traditional conservative or Christian democratic parties. Because of the, if you think back to the 2x2 metrics, because of the culture war issues, this was their political home, and that if such an electoral alternative is available, then these voters simply are unavailable for the populist right. However, if such an alternative is lacking or taken over by the populist right, then this religion gap breaks down. And we could see that, for instance, one of the arguments why in Germany the AfD continues to do so poorly amongst Catholics and Protestants is the existence of the CDU-CSU, the Christian Democratic Party of Angela Merkel, that just provides an alternative. And that part of the reason why Trump initially did poorly among practicing Christians was that their first choice in the primaries were people like Jeb Bush, Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio, but that once these alternatives were eliminated, because they were Republican voters, they defaulted to the Republican candidate. But the second, there's a second factor, and the second and perhaps most overlooked factor behind the religion gap is the behavior of the institutional churches and of faith leaders themselves. And here, the example, and specifically their willingness to create a social taboo around the populist right. And here, I think the example, the comparison between Germany and the US is quite telling, because in Germany, the churches have really been able to erect a quite powerful social taboo around voting for the AfD by really positioning themselves very clearly in the pro-immigration camp, by demonstrating at AfD conferences that this slogan says, "Our cross has no swastika," and they did that in front of the AfD's party conference. They have excluded AfD politicians from speaking at church events, and as a result, they've really become, in public, been perceived as some of the most robust public adversaries to the far right, which in turn has created an association of, they've raised the social costs for church members to associate with the far right, because there's been a clear social taboo set up for that. And this is just like one example. The same is true in other European countries. I think there was a recent article, which I really liked for the title, that they were talking about a Pope Francis effect that was basically showing that whenever the Pope spoke out in favor of migration against the far right, you could see among French practicing Catholics, support for immigration go up and support for the Rassemblement National go down, which shows that this moral authority of church leaders still plays a role. But that conversely, if faith leaders, for whatever reason, are unable or unwilling to create such a taboo, that the vaccination effect then becomes weaker or even disappears. For me, what was really interesting in the US was that I fully expected most faith leaders to be quite pro-Trump or to be at least justifying Trump. But when I spoke to them in private, they were actually similarly skeptical of Trumpism as many of their European counterparts. And there are actually also a couple of studies that suggest that at least initially the criticism of people like Russell Moore, the NAE or Christianity Today might actually have been more representative of evangelical clergy writ large than just of an evangelical elite. So the NAA has some interesting survey data from the primaries, where I think only something like 2% of evangelical pastors favored Donald Trump. And as a result, Donald Trump had to initially also surround himself with more, let's say, marginal figures in the evangelical world, people like Paula White, who had beforehand, I don't think, been particularly prominent as an evangelical, as a representative of mainstream evangelicalism. However, unlike in Europe, this private skepticism did not translate into the same social taboo. And I've, in my research, basically made the claim that this is due to two reasons. If you can go to the next slide. On the one hand, there is there's a difference in faith leaders' willingness to speak up, and secondly, there's a difference in faith leaders' ability to be heard. And that itself, and I don't want to go too much into that and bore you with the constitutional, religious constitutional law, but it's basically to some extent shaped by the system of church-state separation that you have in a country. So for instance, faith leaders' willingness to publicly oppose right-wing populism is in some ways easier if you have a more established system, simply because faith leader self-perception is very different. So if you have a populist rhetoric that is about anti-elitism, anti-establishment, and you are the Archbishop of Canterbury and you crown the king, it's kind of hard to make the case that you are like anti-establishment and anti-elite, or you might at least not perceive yourself as anti-system and anti-elite, whereas in the US, where you have at least a nominal separation of state and church, it's much easier to create this narrative of being persecuted, of being marginalized, even if empirically there's a big question mark if that is actually the case. The second part is the access to policymakers. If you have Lord Bishops in the House of Lords, or if, like in Germany, the big denominations are institutionally involved in the policymaking process, you can also voice criticism perhaps a little more easily of the governing party, because regardless of what you're saying, you have this institutional voice, whereas a lot of people I talked to in the US were saying, well, we don't really like Trump and even of his faith advisory council, but if you want to have influence, you can't say anything negative publicly, you have to have a good personal relationship, and all the criticism you voice has to be private. And then a final point is the church internal power dynamics, which once again, if you are a vicar in the Church of England or a priest for the Catholic Church, you are accountable to your bishop. So in some ways, you can say things that your congregation might not like to hear. Whereas in the United States, more often than not, and especially in evangelicalism, you are financially dependent also on your congregation, and it's much more, if you tell them things they might not like to hear, they might just go to a different church. This is somewhat undermining the willingness of faith leaders to speak up. And then finally, you also, the ability to be heard. So even if they speak up, it's somewhat harder in the United States, because in Europe, you will have clearly identifiable church leaders. For instance, in Germany, we like hierarchy. So even our Protestantism, we have a conference of Protestant bishops, and they vote for a head of the conference of Protestant bishops. And then you have the Pope. And then if these two speak together, they can have a claim of a quasi-monopoly of speaking for Christianity. Whereas in the US, of course, with several thousand denominations, there's nobody who can speak ex officio with the same authority. And then also in the US, it's just that the status of public of the public status of faith leaders is much more dependent on individual charisma than on institutional positions, which makes it somewhat harder to speak with the same authority. And that then obviously impacts the existence of the social taboo, which then in turn has an impact on the strength of the religious vaccination effect. To be sure, outspoken reactions of the churches can also come at a high risk. So it's not that I'm advocating for that, because we see also in Europe a lot of criticism that the church creating social taboos is leading to further social exclusion, radicalization of far-right supporters, as well as to the politicization of Christianity itself. But it does show, it does suggest that faith leaders can actually play quite an important role in that. And with that, I'm coming to an end. I think, do you have another slide? Yeah, I ended with questions, but I think your questions are probably better than mine. So I'm looking forward to the discussion. If you can do the next slide. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tobias, for that wonderful overview of all the similarities and the important differences, and explaining those differences for us between religion and populism on both sides of the Atlantic. We've got about 12 minutes now for Q&A. No, that's fine. Are you able to stay afterwards? If you're able to stay afterwards, our speaker will stick around for those conversations. But let's go into our Q&A time now. I see a hand in the back and then over here. Yes. Yeah, there's a, my colleague Imogene has a microphone for you.
Thank you. Dawn Eden Goldstein, independent scholar. Thank you for your presentation, for your extensive research. I realize that your research being largely, if it's all right to use this term, sociological, is looking more at the dynamics of the appeal and of what people are saying in order to have the appeal, not looking so much at the motivations of people trying to get power. At the same time, given that you've done so many interviews, I wonder if you might have any thoughts with regard to some of the coalitions we've seen. You talked about at the nationalism conference, religious, non-religious people being on the same panel. I was wondering what you'd have to say about some of the coalitions we've seen between, for example, the Napa Institute here in the United States, which is elite Catholic millionaires and billionaires with tradition, family, and property, which is a Brazilian group that has had a long time presence in the United States, and you know, when these people make coalitions, I'm just wondering what's their goal with regard to power, because it doesn't seem like ideals are at the heart of it.
No, I think it's a really good question. Like, obviously, it's always hard to look into people's hearts. I do think, obviously, power plays a big role in that, and the wish for power. And I do think also, like, you might even want to have power and convince yourself that this is not about power, but about survival. So you justify towards yourself that this is not you grabbing power, but this is, like, this persecution narrative. And I think that narrative, that has been much more prominent among Christians in the US, if I compare to Europe, which is somewhat ironic because in Europe, Christians actually are a minority, whereas that is not the case in the United States. But I think where the populist right has been quite successful, and where I think maybe also the center-left could... And I've talked a lot to friends who are working for the Democratic Party, is that they have allowed the populist right to paint the Democratic Party as a secularist party that is, in essence, hostile to religion. I think if you ask the Black Church leaders, they will not necessarily agree with that. But I think this narrative is quite powerful in the US. And I think this narrative is then often used as a justification for anything. And that is actually something I've been the last few days, I just told Judd about that. I've been in a lot of conversations, both with people from the center-left in the US, and I gave this talk to a few people in more center-left and some more center-right institutions and groups. And I was quite struck that when I talked to some of my colleagues who would see themselves more on the center-left side, they would say, I mean, we have to talk to the populist side, we have to understand, so they're in a similar epistemological universe as I am. But then they said, but the elections are getting rigged now. The other side is not playing by the rules, and this is now an existential election. So maybe we have to stop following the rules, maybe we have to break the rules from now on. And I heard exactly the same words from the center-right. And that was interesting to me because neither of them were like extremists, but like I think both sides are currently in a place where this is becoming more existential, and the idea that if the other side wins, our democracy is at risk. And I think actually they actually believe that. Both sides actually believe that. And I sometimes felt like, why don't you go into the other group? You might be a little bit reassured about the place of your side. But I think this is really powerful in the US and then used very effectively also among Christians. And then it can justify most things more easily.
Thank
you. Yeah.
And here, did you have a question?
Yeah.
Just behind you,
Dr.
Yeah.
Thank you for a great talk. Thank you so much. And I've been reading your research for quite a while. So
You mentioned the National Conservative, and it got me thinking about Yoram Azoni, who's arguably the leader of the movement and the president of the Edmund Burke Foundation. And although he's a Jew, he promotes cultural Christianity, and he says it should be promoted in countries in which Christianity is the traditional religion. And it also reminded me of Éric Zemmour in France. Mm-hmm. And that brings me to my question, which has to do with a slight maybe decline. I'm not sure if you mentioned it in your previous research, in the immunization effects.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because Zemmour kind of was a big hit with conservative Catholics, practicing Catholics in France. And I don't have hard data to substantiate that, but I've read about it quite extensively, and also in my research I've come across this. And the second question has to do with the fact that some very devout Catholics are quite okay with cultural Christianity. And I don't know if you came across this piece in The American Conservative by Sohrab Ahmari, Gladden Papin, and Chad Pecknold, in which they say, well, we know they're not seriously Catholic, like Salvini, Marion Maréchal. She just got remarried after getting a divorce. And Orban is not even a Catholic. But, you know, at least it's better than a liberal, anti-religious atmosphere. And this may lead to some flourishing of religion down the road. And there has always been a cultural dimension to Christianity. So,
No, I think you are absolutely right, and you are completely right that it's really interesting that this religious vaccination effect that we've seen in France for decades, last election somewhat disappeared, or like at least became significantly smaller, disappeared. I think the data on that is still out, but you're absolutely right. Éric Zemmour did significantly better than somebody like Marine Le Pen in that. And I think there are really two factors that play into that. One is the factor that also for the first time the Catholic Church, the Catholic authorities in France, have decided not to make any statement. Like in 2005, the last time that Jean-Marie Le Pen was running was in the second round, the Catholic bishops stood up, which they usually don't do in France, and said, like, you cannot vote for Le Pen. In 2017, it was already a little bit quieter. They didn't do it officially, but it was still very much clear. In 2022, they didn't say anything at all. So there was no clear taboo communicated. And then it's exactly that, and then I think the second factor was also that the traditional Republican home of French Catholics, the Republican Party, entirely evaporated. So in 2017, François Fillon, who was their main candidate, still got 55% of French practicing Catholics. But in France, that doesn't get you to the second round of the elections anymore. He was only at 20% and was eliminated. In 2021, this party, I think, got 2% or something like that. So in some ways, French Catholicism, French political Catholicism, had the sense of being politically homeless. And because Macron's party has not really tried to make an appeal to these voters, as you say, then for them the decision is, do we prefer, I had one of their leaders who actually told me, we are between the pest of an identitarian anti-immigrant far right and the cholera of a socially nihilist Macron, this is how they put it. And then we'd rather have the far right who at least pay lip service. They're both secular, but we prefer the secular right that pay lip service to Christianity over the secular left that doesn't even do that. But I think one of the big questions is, and I think this is like part of the question I want to raise with my research, is it's somewhat up to faith leaders and Christian communities themselves whether they... what their idea of Christianity is, whether they want to buy into, and maybe in a secular society, cultural Christianity is the future. But I think, but it's a question that I would pose to faith communities, whether that is the future of Christianity that they would like, or whether they would like a different one. But I think that is something to be answered by faith communities and faith leaders themselves, but we can indeed see both possibilities. We can see an alliance between the traditional Christian right and the secular right, or we can see an opposition between the two. And I think the big question will be for faith leaders and Christians themselves, which way they'd rather go. Thank you.
We just have a few minutes left in our formal time together. So I saw a hand from Dr. Hollenbach, and then was there a hand back there? Tom, did you have your hand up? So we'll take those two questions together. As briefly as you can, please. Yes.
Thank you very much. Yes. Thank you very much for your fine presentation. I found it really fascinating. And one question I have for you, going back to the very beginning of your presentation, where you were making the argument that the identity issue is really what's driving this religious populist movement, rather than economic or particularly cultural, moral values, and so forth. One question that occurred to me was, how is the identity question related to economic issues? I'm not denying the identity issue at all, but I'd be interested to know whether or not, I'm thinking here in the United States, we know that poor, or let's say less educated white people in the United States voted for Donald Trump significantly more than better educated white people in the United States did. And that education issue is very closely connected to economic status. So I'm wondering about how, I mean, the identity question could be seen independent of that other variable, but I'm wondering how and whether or not you've investigated whether there is a connection between the identitarian commitments and the economic or educational level of people. I know that it may be different in Germany from the United States, but I know the supporters of the AFT would probably be more educated than would be the supporters of Trump in this country. So I'm just wondering how that really works out from your point of view.
No, thank you for bringing that.
Let me just bring in the second question just for the sake of time.
Tom Walsh with the Trinity Forum. I just wanted to focus a little bit on the Catholic versus Protestant distinction within Europe and see what, if you've been able to identify much of an effect in terms of immunization. And I'm particularly thinking of Italy and Spain, because unlike France, they don't have a long history of secularism. They had a history of very strong religio-social control until fairly recently. Is it a very distinctive expression, or is it really not so different from what you see in the Protestant countries?
I'll start with that. It's been quite interesting the divide is both for Protestants and Catholics, usually the religious vaccination effect. And you see the religious vaccination effect also in countries like Italy historically. And some people have even argued that we just had a Spanish scholar who unfortunately had to leave, but he had a quick chat about that, that until relatively recently, until the 2020s, in Spain there was no far-right movement, and part of the argument was that in Spain conservative Catholics would be conservative, but never fascist because of the history of Franco, and that therefore it was taboo. Political Catholicism had their home in the Popular Party, in the center-right party. But now you obviously have the Vox Party, and it's quite interesting. I actually haven't seen the recent data. I know that they initially did best among cultural Catholics who weren't practicing Catholics. I don't know what the most recent data on that is, but that would align with what we are seeing in France. And in Germany. Similarly, in Italy, for decades, there was a very powerful immunization effect. And for instance, Salvini still did significantly worse among practicing Catholics. And you actually had really interesting debates happening in Italy, where again, you see there's also a debate between cultural Catholics and perhaps more practicing Catholics, where the far right actually said, because the Pope is very outspoken against the far right in Italy. And then the far right said, well, the Pope isn't a real Catholic. This isn't our Pope. And they ran around with Benedict T-shirts to basically make a theological claim about who's the actual Pope, and we are more Catholic than the Pope. But it does also suggest that we are seeing trends of secularization there, where you have political movements that actually can question the authority of the Catholic authorities in many ways, and their monopoly over the idea of Christianity. And I think that plays into that. And if you ask me, I actually think that the vaccination effect is probably going to become weaker as secularization processes, because we have some indication that's the case in a couple of European countries. As to the question of economics and education, I'm really glad you brought that up, because I think that's a really important piece in the puzzle. And I would actually make a distinction between education and economics here, because what was interesting in the Trump campaign, in the US elections, but also in Europe, and actually this is something that we can see across borders, that education is a very strong predictor for not voting for the far right, and poor education is a strong indicator for voting for the far right. But economically, the most economically vulnerable, the correlation isn't that clear, because the most economically vulnerable still tend to vote in Europe far left parties, and also in the US still tend to vote more for the Democratic Party, the really economically deprived. So there hasn't been such a clear economic income correlation between...
Are you referring to blacks and Hispanics there?
Yeah, but even for whites, like the really poor whites still didn't necessarily vote for Trump. But what you're right, like his main supporters was the white working class, who are not economically doing terribly, and I think on average Trump voters actually were slightly wealthier than Hillary voters, but significantly less educated. And it's more a question of relative status loss. People in the white working class, they might actually be financially relatively secure, but their status is undermined. I think the Ari Holschild book about Strangers in Our Own Land really points to that. It's much more about social status than about effective economic income. And I think the educational part plays an important role in that. But that is also interesting when we look at it from the religious side, because historically we had this narrative of like the more educated you are, the more secular you are, and the less educated you are, the more religious you are. But what we are seeing in Europe, but also in the US, is actually a shift of that the most rapidly secularizing groups is the white working class. Whereas the upper middle class tends to be more religious. So religion, also churches and congregations, become more socially privileged in a way. And that is really essential if you think about books like Bob Putnam about social capital. Religion was historically the key source of social capital, especially for those economically less well off. And with secularization, this source of social capital is falling away, and that might then contribute even stronger to an identity crisis, because it's much harder to replace that. They can't necessarily afford to instead go and join a yoga club or a golf club, which perhaps some of their more like educated secular neighbors might do. So I think the interaction between the two is a really important piece of the puzzle. So thanks a lot for bringing that up.
Well, unfortunately, we've come to the end of our time. Thank you for those questions. If others of you did have questions, feel free to stick around and chat informally with our speaker. And if you want to dive in more, the book is The Godless Crusade. You can find it on Amazon or the Cambridge University Press website. But let's join together in thanking our speaker.